After retiring, Justice Broderick became the Dean and President of the University of New Hampshire School of Law here in Concord. Justice Broderick left the School of Law in 2015, and since that time has been working on the project Change Direction New Hampshire. At this time, I'd like to give a warm NEA welcome to Chief Justice John Broderick.
My remarks to 3 hours. I will do that. It's really a pleasure to be here. I come from a family of teachers, by the way. My father was a science teacher. He was one of those really smart people who understood chemistry. My wife taught the fourth grade. My aunt taught school. My sister was a teacher. And so I know what your job's about, and I respect it. I respect it. Let me tell you why I'm here this morning, however. I'm here to ask for your help, because I need your help. I need everyone's help. The issue of mental health and mental illness is very personal to me, and it may well be to many of you here. You know, the old adage, if you want to make God laugh, tell him your plans. It wasn't my plan to be speaking to teachers about mental illness. But oddly enough, it may be the most important thing I've done in my professional life, and I've had some wonderful opportunities. But this is the most important thing I've done. When I was a child, I remember it clearly, I was 10 years old, and my best friend in this town north of Boston, on our leafy street. My best friend lived across that street. His father graduated from MIT. And his father's brother was an inpatient, confined inpatient, at Danvers Mental Hospital in Danvers, Massachusetts. They used to call it the Nut House when I was a kid. Pretty frightening to a 10-year-old. And in the summertime, my friend's father would pick his brother up at Danvers, bring him to our town for Sunday cookouts. And I distinctly remember seeing him walking around the yard across the street, sometimes with his brother, sometimes by himself. Oftentimes, just looking at the flowers next to the garage, I was pretty scared looking at him. And on those Sundays, I never crossed the street. I never visited my friend on those Sundays in the summer. But I was happy that I didn't have to know that man or deal with that problem, and I was happy he was locked away. Decades later, in a different town, in a different state, on a different street, mental illness came across the street into my own home, disguised and undetected, and took up residence in my family and almost destroyed my family. It brought me to the intensive care unit at the Elliott Hospital. It brought my oldest son to the state prison, and it almost killed us. And all of that played out at the time in a very public way across the front pages of the state, and to some extent in newspapers around the United States. My doctors appeared on the Today Show to talk about my health. And all of that journey that my family endured and other families endured journeys too was largely unnecessary. That's the hardest thing to think about. Because I didn't know about mental health or mental illness. I didn't know the signs. I wouldn't know what to look for. My son, who's a really good person, did not know he had a mental illness. And my wife and I made really bad choices based on information that now turns out to be incorrect. And so my son suffered all those years. And when he was at the prison, and I was on the Supreme Court, by the way, so it was a little uncomfortable. All the people, by the way, in the state prison have committed felonies, and so they appealed to our court. And so I said to my son, who I love, I said, if it makes you uncomfortable here, which I can understand, let me know and I'll step down. It's my job, it's not as important as your life. He said, no, Dad, I don't want you to do that. If it gets bad, I'll tell you. One day he called me and said, Dad, you're really popular at the prison today. I said, really? What about that? He said, I don't know, but they think you're fabulous today. So he must have reversed their conviction. All that means is you're going to get a second trial, and I'm going free. He said, I won't tell them that. I said, that's a good choice. My son was married in prison to a woman who had received her master's degree with him. It was not an elaborate ceremony, and the reception was inexpensive. And I performed the wedding in a conference room off the prison visiting room. I had a very good view of the Coke machine. And the photographer was an inmate. Seemed like a nice fellow. And I said, are you expensive? He said, no, I'm a dollar a picture. They had a Polaroid camera, so maybe that's appropriate. And I said, thank you, I can afford you. The first night we visited my son in the state prison, and I hadn't seen him, he came into the room, and he gave me a big hug, and he said, Dad, I can never, ever forgive myself. I said, I can't forgive myself either. I said, we got into this together, we're going to get out of it together. And we have. We have. As I said, he's married. His wife won an Emmy for her work in film in New England. And they have the most beautiful 8-year-old daughter on the planet Earth, and I'm totally unbiased. But she is. When my son was released from that prison after 3 long years, they let him out on parole because he was such a good inmate. It would be like me being in prison. My son's really smart, really decent, movie star handsome. He really is. And really decent man. And when we met with a prison psychiatrist, he said, Judge, your son has serious depression, anxiety, and panic attacks that are almost off the charts. I didn't know that. I didn't know that. My son was drinking. They said, your son's an alcoholic. He wasn't an alcoholic. He was self-medicated, like a lot of people do who have a mental health problem. He said, if we can help your son, he has every life skill you need to be successful. And I owe my family's survival and my son's well-being to the state prison, by the way, because it helped him. And when he left the prison after 3 years, Channel 9 came because I was the Chief Justice. And they thought that was an interesting story, apparently. No more interesting than any other family's journey. So they said to me with a microphone under my mouth, do you have anything to say? I said, actually, I do have something to say. I said, my son was not a bad person, he's now good. He's always been a good person, but he's now well. And those are very different things. And they are, by the way. That first Thanksgiving, we were driving, my son and I had to pick something up at the grocery store. He was in the passenger seat. He was tapping his chest, and he said, Dad, have you always felt like this? I said, what do you mean, Christian, like this? He said, good, I mean, Dad. I didn't know you could feel like that. He hasn't had a drop to drink in a dozen years. He was never an alcoholic. Never. He also told me that he was in the same prison. They gave me an IQ test, and he said, "Dad, I was 3 points below genius on the IQ test." And I said, "So you couldn't be a genius, huh?" He said, "Dad, my ankles were shackled, and they were watching me through a two-way mirror when I was taking the test. That's going to be worth 3 points." I said, "You're a genius, I agree." For a long time, I didn't know what to do. But in the aftermath of that tragedy, people would come up to me. I was on the court, and so people would stop me. I didn't know them. And every single person who stopped me had a story about themselves, their mother, their father, their sister, their uncle. It was eye-opening to me. I remember going home one night, I said to my wife, "You know, we're suffering publicly, which is hard, but it's better than suffering privately, in the shadows, ashamed." There are a lot of people, by the way, in this state and around the country, who live in fear of innocent questions at the grocery store, the pharmacy, the ball field. "How's your son doing? Is your daughter in school now? Where's she working? Is your son married?" They don't know how to answer those questions. They said, "Never, ever, 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 ever going to tell you that their son or daughter has a mental health problem." One thing I have learned in our journey is that everyone with a mental illness shares two things in common. One is they didn't ask for it, and two is they don't deserve it. But there's such huge stigma about mental health. And you know what that stigma is, by the way? It's all of us. We're the people who created the stigma that keeps people in the shadows and ashamed. When I was growing up, one of my friends at school had a mother who was ill. I was a kid. I still remember 1957, by the way. It was a great year. I was a lot younger. My parents were both living. I had no responsibilities. I didn't realize how good those years were. But anyway, one day I came in from playing, and I said to my mother, just the two of us now in the kitchen, I said, "Mom, what's wrong with Jimmy's mother?" And my mother had a look on her face that was painful. Like she was going to have to tell me something she didn't want to tell me. Now remember, we're alone. And she bent down and she whispered the word cancer. She whispered the word cancer. The two of us in our kitchen alone. Apparently, I thought if you said it out loud, you might contract cancer. Maybe that's why she was whispering. In 1957, the only adult that I ever heard say the word breast in public was Hugh Hefner. Playboy magazine was founded in 1954. Hugh Hefner was the only one that said that. So in 1957, no one said the word breast publicly. And people whispered the word cancer. Decades later, we say breast cancer. I can't look at the color pink without thinking of breast cancer. Last year, 280,000 women across this country were diagnosed with breast cancer. Their outcomes are dramatically different because people have the courage to say breast and cancer together and get a megaphone and a collar and make a difference across this country. In the 1980s, AIDS was first discussed. That was a scary time too. And people thought, maybe they're just bad people. Maybe they're deviant people. Maybe I could get AIDS if I know someone with AIDS. Maybe if I breathe the same air, I can get AIDS. And then Magic Johnson of the Los Angeles Lakers took a podium in California and said, I have HIV. Everyone loved Magic Johnson. And suddenly it was okay to have HIV. It used to be a death sentence. It's not now. It's not now. Mental illness still remains shameful. Not to me, and maybe not to some of you. But it remains shameful and in the shadows. We need to change it. We need to change it. Otherwise, you're going to consign another generation of young people and older adults, or any one of us, to the solitude of the shadows. But it's just not right. It's not right. Last fall, I was asked to contact a woman, a child psychologist. Her name is Barbara Naylor. She's about 50 years old, and she's from Maryland. And she has a campaign which she calls Change Direction. It's a national campaign, and she wanted to roll it out first in New Hampshire. She said, you're first in the nation in politics. You ought to be first in the nation in healthcare and mental health care. So I called her. And because of Google, don't you love Google? It's amazing what I know about people I'm never going to meet. But I do enjoy it. In any event, I looked her up. And she was on Time Magazine's 100 list, the 100 most influential people on the planet in 2012. Now, all of us have been on that list at one time or another in our dreams. And so I knew that when I called her. And I instantly liked her. I said, Barbara, what are you trying to do? She said, John, this is what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to make the 5 most common signs of mental illness as well known and as widely known as the signs of a heart attack or a stroke. And when she said that, I thought, that is genius. It's genius. She said, you know the signs of a heart attack or a stroke. And you didn't go to medical school. Well, that's true for all of us. We know most of those signs. And lives have been saved because we know them. Heck, I even know the Heimlich maneuver. How do I know that? But I do know it. She said, John, I want to change the culture around mental illness. This campaign is non-political, nonpartisan information and awareness. I want to start a discussion in kitchens and living rooms across this country, in pediatricians' offices, in the workplace, on the playing field, in the gymnasium, about mental health and mental illness. Just like we've accepted every other physical illness in America, we need to accept mental health issues for what they are. And we need to stop defining people by their illness. I might say you have heart disease, you have cancer, but when it comes to mental illness, I say you are mentally ill. No, you're not. You have a mental illness. We define the mentally ill as their illness. We don't do that anywhere else. Why is that? Why do we do that? We used to lock people away who were mentally ill. At one time, we had over 3,000 people at the state hospital. Those people died twice, by the way. They died when they were admitted, and they died when they buried them. We didn't want them out among us. It was shameful and frightening. My friend's uncle, all those years ago, today he wouldn't be hospitalized in an institution. I know that. We did that to him, by the way. All of us did that. And in different ways, we're all doing it. I include myself. Let me make one thing clear as I've talked this morning. I am not here to say you need to be righteous and tough and like I am, because I'm not righteous and I'm not tough. And I'm not particularly courageous. My son's courageous. My son's maybe the bravest person I know. My wife is courageous. I was pretty ignorant. I made a lot of mistakes. You don't want to make those mistakes. I don't think. I don't recommend them to you. So after I spoke to Barbara, I reached out to form a steering committee. It was the easiest thing I had ever done. The Attorney General himself said yes. The head of HHS said yes. The head of Corrections said yes. The head of Safety, hospital CEOs, mental health professionals, families, the Catholic bishop, the Episcopal bishop, every member of our congressional delegation, every member of our congressional delegation, regardless of party. Governor Hassan said yes. Attorney General, I mean, it was extraordinary. And by the way, the largest providers of mental health services in the United States are jails and prisons. Is that a good model? $38,000 a year to incarcerate someone that's in prison. Sometimes you need to. But sometimes if we discovered mental illness when people were younger, we could avoid that expense and save lives. Barbara Van Dalen, whose genius this campaign is, gave me the following statistics, which I hope upset you and concern you as much as they did me. Half of all mental illness in the United States, half, arises by age 14. That would be my son, age 13. Most people who have a mental health problem don't know they have a mental health problem. They just think it's to them. They think it's a personal weakness. And so they don't say anything. How would they know? How would they know what normal felt like? 2/3 of all mental illness arises by age 23. Last year in the United States, more people died from suicide than on the highways of this country. Every 90 minutes or so, a veteran takes his or her own life. Every 90 minutes of every day, of every week, of every month, of every year, and we do not talk about it. Why is that? Why is that? We launched this campaign in the House chamber. 400 seats there. It was not a session day, as Scott said. Every single seat was filled. And I knew then, I knew that morning, that this issue affects and touches so many families. Annie Custer, I don't know if she's ever told the story. She stood up that morning in front of 425 people and said, I have a nephew, Eric, and Eric hears voices. And Eric and I were supposed to go to a wedding, and he said, Annie, if the voices get too loud, we may have to leave. And she said, okay, let's see how that goes, Eric. So they went to the wedding, and Annie said, he was speaking in a low voice to the voices throughout the whole service. But they got through it. And when it was done, she said, Eric, that was great. We got through that. And he turned to her and said, Annie, wasn't that a beautiful service? And she said, in that moment, I realized there's a person in here, just like me. He has a mental health problem. But he sees what I see. He experienced what I experienced. I then went around to try to raise money. Don't worry, I'm not asking. I went to hospitals and met with CEOs. Every single person I asked donated money. And finally, I got to within about 15 grand of our $150,000 goal. And I called Governor Benson, who had appointed me Chief Justice. By the way, he made great judicial appointments. That's my story. In any event, I called him, and I know he does work, charity work with kids, and I told him what I was doing. He said, how much money do you need? I said, I need $15,000 going. He said, I'll send you a check. He did. A week before we launched, this is mental illness and shame and stigma in real time. I went over to the western part of the state and was going to speak to professional people. I hadn't met them. And I hadn't met the woman who was going to host it, but she said she would host it. I talked to her for 5 minutes while the room, conference room was filling up. I spoke for 20 minutes, I invited everyone to the launch, and then I left. About 3 days later, I got a voicemail on my cell phone. It was a woman's voice. I had no idea who she was. I didn't recognize the name. And I just assumed it was the wrong number. So the next morning, I called the number, hoping the woman would say, oh my gosh, I called the wrong number. She didn't say that. She said, thanks for calling back. So I knew I was in trouble. I had no idea who she was. She said, you don't remember me, but I'm the woman that hosted the meeting 3 days ago. I said, of course. I'm sorry, of course. And I thought she was calling to say, I want to come to the launch. She had met me for 5 minutes in a room that was filling up with people. She said, my husband was hospitalized yesterday with depression, anxiety, and mood disorder, and then she started crying. So I don't know how much longer we can do this. She said, I called you yesterday because I was going to ask you tomorrow if I could visit my husband in the hospital. I never met her. I said, I would have, you know. She said, I know you would have. That's why I called you. But you can't come now because you'd be too ashamed. You'd be too ashamed. I said, what should you tell his employer? She said, you can't tell people you have depression. This is 2016. I said, what if he broke his hip? Oh, she said, we would have told him. What if he had emergency coronary bypass? Oh, we definitely would have told him that. I went on the radio after the launch with Barbara and the psychiatrist and Barbara Hitchcock, and it was a great program because of them. And so I called her on my way south, and I said, why don't you listen tonight? They rebroadcast it. I didn't know whether they would or not. So she called me several days later. She said, Joe and I, first time I knew his name, by the way, Joe and I listened to it. He was really inspired by it. He wanted me to call you and ask me if he'd come visit with both of us. So I was thinking, I'm going to be arrested for practicing medicine pretty soon. But I know the pain. I do know that. So I said, sure, I'll come. So I spent 2 hours with him. I met Joe, and within 10 minutes, Joe was unloading his life on me, in a good way. He'd wanted to tell somebody for a long time, but was too ashamed. He had a very good job, by the way. I couldn't imagine how he did that job with his illness. Simply hiding it. I said, Joe, you are an amazing guy. And he smiled. I said, you mean that? I said, I do. You have a hard job, but you've been doing that job climbing Mount Everest at night in a hailstorm every day of your life. I said, do me a favor, will you? He said, what? I said, stop being ashamed. Stop being ashamed. And as I drove home that day, I thought, you know, the reason he's ashamed is because of me and people just like me. Everywhere I speak, people come up to me and share their stories because they need to. I asked Joe McQuaid at the union leader when we launched this campaign if he would allow us to publish a first-person account once a month in the union leader from someone with mental health problems, someone who's done well with treatment, or a family member. He said, why do you want to do that? I said, I want to do it because I want people to know that they're not alone on the island. They're not the only family on the block, in their town, in their school, with a mental health issue. I want them to know they have company, and in that, they'll find some comfort. And so Joe is doing that. And people are reading them, at least they tell me they are. I appeared before the mayor and alderman in Manchester. The mayor said, you have 2,500 rat cards. That's a rat card. That's the five simple emoticon faces of mental illness. My goal is to get one in every refrigerator in New Hampshire. Simple. But it will matter. Mayor Gunn said, can I get 2,500 of those? I said, people can do it, 2,500. He said, I thought you wanted them in every refrigerator. I said, that's a good point. So he said, I'm going to give them to teachers, I'm going to give them to employees. And I spoke for 12 minutes in an evening meeting. They let me go first. The real agenda was going to follow me. So there were 50 people behind me. And this is not a statement about me. It's a statement about this. And so when I finished speaking, I stood up and thanked them for listening. And suddenly, everyone behind me started applauding. And then the people on the council started applauding, and the mayor started applauding. The same thing happened in Keene. Why? Because all those people, strangers to me, have some problem they've been hiding, something they've been ashamed of, something they're dealing with, and finally, somebody was saying, it's okay. It's okay. When I left the chamber, the head of the waterworks department said to me, you have 27,000 of these? Imagine. I said, is there a black market on you? Maybe I should be selling them on Elm Street. I said, what are you going to do with 27,000? Why not? He said, I thought you just said you're one of them on every refrigerator. I hate that. I said, actually, I did say that. He said, well, I'm going to mail them out to our customers. The Catholic Bishop of Manchester opened up the opportunity for me to speak to every Catholic school principal in New Hampshire about a month ago. A week ago, he wrote a letter to every priest and deacon in this state about this campaign, asking them to hold mental health forums to display our materials. The Episcopal bishop was just as warm and gracious and did exactly the same thing. Maggie Hassan and Kelly Ayotte, who could not agree on this podium, agreed on this campaign. They agreed on this campaign. Not about politics. It's not about politics. A couple weeks ago, I was speaking on a Saturday night in Salem to a group of people that heard about the campaign, and they pushed me into the program. The Governor Hassan had spoken, and Jeff Myers, the Commissioner of Health and Human Services, had spoken, and I was asked to speak, and so I did. And 15 minutes after I finished, the current president of the state senate, Chuck Morris, took the stage to present the award to someone in the audience. It was a large meeting, there was press present, so I don't feel I'm sharing in confidence. And he stood up and he said, Judge Broderick mentioned Danvers Mental Hospital in his remarks tonight. My father, he said, was a patient at Danvers Hospital 6 months out of every year for most of my childhood. And I wanted to stand up and applaud that he did that. He might have told me or told them that his father had heart disease or broke his leg or was confined to a wheelchair. But for somebody of his stature to stand up in a public place and disclose that was a huge step forward. The bullseye of mental illness is ages 12 to 23. One of the reasons I was grateful when Scott allowed me to come today. You people see the bullseye every day of the week. We need to know more, We need to be more vigilant. We need to be less judgmental. We need to change the culture around mental health. I was asked by the principal and superintendent of Durham to come. I went to Oyster River High School last week. I spent 8 hours there. And they let me speak to assemblies of kids, 7th and 8th graders, 9th and 10th graders, 11th and 12th graders. Let me tell you something about these kids. They are amazing. Non-judgmental, open. One other problem, they're going to change the culture of mental illness if you want to wait another 25 years. I don't want to wait. The problem is generally not with the kids, it's with us. It's with us. I've spoken to school counselors who say, kids are pretty forthcoming, but their parents don't want to hear that their child is not perfect. I spoke to someone at a private school and said, sometimes when I call parents, they say to me, don't let this get out. Because my son or daughter won't get to Yale or Harvard or Princeton. I spoke to someone in the western part of the state at a school. They said, kids might come to me, but when I say, well, this should be covered under your parents' insurance, they say, no, no, don't, I can't do that. I can't love my parents now. That's a problem, folks. That's our problem. Our problem. Let me close with this, and then I'm going to make an ask. Not about money, by the way. We went over to the Keen Sentinel. Peter Evers, who's the CEO of Riverbend in Concord, and Bill Gunn, who's the director of behavioral health at Concord Hospital, and I co-chaired this campaign. And so we went over to see the Keen newspaper, the Sentinel, their editorial board, a couple of months back, and they wrote a very nice piece supporting this. And as we were sitting there after the interview with 5 members of the Keen paper, the publisher said to me, he addressed it to me, he said, John, how are you going to sustain this campaign? How are you going to sustain this? I said, how am I going to sustain it? How am I going to sustain it? I would if I could. If I had the time and the money, I would devote my life to it. But I can't do that. But I said, if you think this campaign, matters, let me ask you a question. How are we going to sustain it? If this is not a good time in American life, with kids dying of overdoses, many of them associated with mental health problems, by the way, if we're not going to deal with it now, if we're not going to drag mental illness out of the shadows where it has spent generations and humanize it and help people and change the culture, when would be a good time? Because I'd be happy to come back. And he smiled and said, now is the time. I said, if this non-political, non-partisan, simple campaign isn't the right one, maybe you have a better idea, I'll take that back to Barbara Vandela. Maybe we'll change it. He said, no, this is the campaign. It's hard to change the culture, but frankly, we are the culture. We are the culture. We just have to persuade ourselves. In my town, in my childhood, my sister and I would go every Thursday night to the downtown restaurant where everyone seemed to go. Must have been payday, I didn't realize it then. And so we go to this restaurant, and every single table had an ashtray. And sometime during the evening, usually with dessert and coffee, every single table was smoking. That would have included my mother and father. So as my sister and I were having gotten a sort of in this smoke-filled room, breathing it in, nobody said, what are you doing? And then we'd drive home in my father's big Chevy, sitting in the back seat with no seatbelt, it didn't exist. Why would you want a seatbelt? And then my parents, one of them would usually smoke on the way home, My sister and I agreed that in. And then when we got home, there were ashtrays in almost every room of our house. Find an ashtray today. Can you find one? You can't even find one in your car today. Do you realize it's against the ordinances in the city of Boston to smoke outside at the Boston Common? If you had asked me one of those nights when my sister and I were breathing in the smoke, do you think there'll ever be a day when people won't be smoking and it'll be outlawed, basically? I would have said, of course not. Never happened. In 1959, we had a great black and white television set. And I used to watch the nightly news. That was a ritual in my house. I think it lasted 15 minutes back then. In any event, occasionally I would see African Americans being attacked by police dogs. It was very disturbing if you're 12 years old. Disturbing at any age, but particularly at 12. And I thought it was in a faraway place. And my mother assured me it was in the United States of America. If you had asked me following one of those newscasts, will there be a time in your life when an African American will be president of this country? I would say, are you crazy? Never happened. Thank you, Barack Obama. What seemed unimaginable is now history. I believe that stigma, which is senseless and harmful, even if unintended, is on every table in America. It's the ashtray of my childhood. We need to get rid of the ashtrays, and you need to help. Because it's your kids, your nephews, your friends' children, your students. As my wife says in some instances, always painful to hear, I think it's time you put your big boy pants on. I think it's time we all put our big boy pants on and change this culture. I need your help. Please take these or ask for them and display them. Take one home. A teacher at Bishop Brady, if you don't think it matters, teacher at Bishop Brady, I spoke to all their teachers recently. She took these to her classroom. She put two of them on her door. At the end of the first week of class, she said a freshman boy came up to her, waited until everyone had left. Because he's learning the lessons too, by the way. And he said to her, in a confidential sense, is our school going to be getting involved in mental health issues and supporting people with those issues? She said, I hope so. He said, can I tell you about my mental health problems? He said, I have a couple of triggers, and maybe you could talk with me to my other teachers. It would be very helpful. And I got an email that told me that would happen. It made my whole day. It made my whole day. Because it's happening in real time. That young man, freshman, would have left that classroom, never, ever would have approached a teacher. We need to be smarter, and we need to change. And if we do, we will save a generation of people like that young man. So please take these, please display them. Please don't be afraid to talk about it. Talk to the school counselors and the school principal. I've been asked to come now to speak at Hollis High School and Trinity High School. I'll go anywhere I'm asked because it's that important to me. And I hope it's important to all of you. Thank you very much for listening.